nanoHUB-U, online instruction.
Hey everyone, welcome to lecture 217. Here we'll talk about how to use S-matrix calculations for an advanced topic, which is calculating the properties of metasurfaces. But first, let me start by explaining what a metasurface really is. The way that you can describe a metasurface essentially is that instead of having an ordinary interface between two dielectric materials, A and B in this case, with indices Ni and Nt, so incident and transmitted refractive indices, then you actually have this extra region in the middle, basically on the surface at that interface, which has a phase. And then the point of the phase is that the phase is actually different as you move across the surface. And so in order to minimize action of the system, which is a very general principle, then you actually need to take a different path than you would otherwise. And so then that path depends on the gradient of the phase as you go across the surface. So delta phi over delta X, or delta R in this case. And so then that actually takes the kind of standard law of reflection, specular reflection, in which the angle of reflection equals angle of incidence. And then it adds this extra term that depends on the gradient of phi. And so you end up with something like this, sine theta R minus sine theta I, which would normally be zero, is now equal to the gradient of phi divided by N I K naught, where K naught is the wave vector in the index medium. And then for refraction, then you have something like Snell's law, which would normally be that this pair of terms is equal to zero, but instead has an extra term equal to gradient of phi over K naught. And so you can actually show that this amounts to momentum conservation. And this will give you very unusual behavior. It's kind of like you look into a mirror, and then the mirror image of yourself would actually be off to the side, say. And so you can actually do really interesting things with this sort of behavior. Now, this actually was shown experimentally a few years ago, that you can actually give rise to a whole bunch of different structures that implement this phase gradient across the surface. And then this phase gradient is with nanostructures small enough so that you don't actually see the nanostructures themselves, like with the optical wavelength. And so in this particular case, what you see is that there are a bunch of different phase elements. So basically one period is highlighted in yellow, and you can see that they're all stacked on top of each other. And then this was demonstrated by Federico Capasso's group at Harvard, and this gives rise to a gradient in the infrared. And then similarly, Vladimir Shalayev's group here at Purdue actually performed a similar feat shortly thereafter in visible wavelength. And then there are other groups that showed other structures can give rise to the same idea, both theoretically and then experimentally as well. So here, like the application we'll consider is like how you can like redirect light for light trapping in photovoltaic absorbers or other types of photodetectors and so on. And so here the concept would be that you'd have a metasurface in the back of a semiconductor. When light comes in, of course, it comes in either at normal or near normal incidence, gets refracted towards the normal because it's coming from a low index medium to a high index medium. But then the metasurface would actually push it away from the escape cone. And then once you do that, then that forces it to be internally reflected. And so it can be fully absorbed in principle, you would think. So it's in other words, complete coupling of the external radiation, even if you have an ultra thin absorber layer, because of this effect. And so here in like a very simple example, we're looking at what is the deflection of a metasurface that's composed of nothing more than a graded index. And so you can see that this graded index, basically the different colors represent different indices, and it's all repeated periodically in this X direction. And then basically the concept is light comes in at normal incidence, it gets reflected back at some angle. And then we can use a tool like S4SIM to actually calculate what is the probability that light will get deflected into this so-called plus one mode compared to the specular reflection mode, which would be on a diagonal of this graph of theta reflected versus theta in, right? And so, of course, specular reflection, theta r equals theta in. In the plus one mode, theta r is much greater than theta in. And so then that's this plus one mode. And so you can see that this kind of design actually works very well if the incident angle is close to normal. But as you move away from the normal, then it degrades in quality. But then if you look at another way, like as a function of wavelength, you can actually see that the angle also changes, which is also an interesting phenomenon. In the next lecture, we'll actually talk about how this can benefit light trapping in solar cells.